Today, just for you, I'm going to break down the difference between complex versus simple carbs on not only fat loss, but also general health markers as well. Hey, this is Colin DeWay. If you want to master your metabolism and create forever results, start now by subscribing and click on that bell notification so you don't miss anything. So when it comes to carb consumption, you've probably heard that you want to stick to mostly complex carbs because they're healthier. However, there are pros and cons to both complex and simple carbs. So make sure you stick around to the end of the video because I'm going to talk about what some of those pros and cons are, as well as digging in some research to look at what really matters when it comes to fat loss and health markers. So if you aren't aware, complex carbs are basically carbs that are slower to digest and slower to release blood sugar. Some examples of complex carbs would be things like oats, veggies, ground rice, quinoa, sweet potatoes, whole wheats, and beans and lentils. Simple carbs are digested faster and create a more rapid increase in blood sugar. And some examples of simple carbs are things like sugar, white bread, honey, pastries, candies, and regular sodas. One factor that many people use to determine if a carb source is complex or simple is the GI rating, which stands for glycemic index. The higher the rating on the GI scale, the faster the increase in blood sugar you get from it, and the lower the rating is, the slower the release in blood sugar is. That being said, I want to point out something that not a lot of people seem to understand, and that is the GI response really only matters if you eat that food by itself in a fasted state. When you consume that food in a mixed meal, it almost completely blunts the GI response and makes it irrelevant. Anyway, all carbs turn into glucose no matter what the source is actually coming from. Simple carbs will elevate blood sugar faster, causing the pancreas to release insulin to bring blood sugar back down. And I think this is a big thing that a lot of people freak out about, is that insulin is actually technically a storage hormone. It basically prompts cells to absorb blood sugar as energy or storage. So yes, insulin is a storage hormone, but you have to understand there's a huge difference between someone who is sedentary and eating in a calorie surplus versus someone who is active and eating in a calorie deficit. And please note, when I talk about this stuff, I'm talking about people who are healthy. This is not going for people who have certain conditions such as diabetes. Anyway, while insulin can store in fat cells, yes, it also stores in muscle cells as well as your liver. And if your muscles are constantly being depleted of glycogen from exercise, then you're going to be replenishing the glycogen in those muscles first. Keep in mind, you're technically always storing and burning fat simultaneously, but most importantly, you have to be in a net overall calorie surplus to gain body fat. Now, that being said, that doesn't mean you should just run out and eat a bunch of simple carb sources and a bunch of junk food, and there's many benefits to complex carbs and a reason why they're typically touted as better. Complex carbs are typically going to be higher in fiber and micronutrients, so they have the benefit of aiding in gastrointestinal health and just overall health and well-being. Complex carbs are also typically more filling, so when calories get lower in a dieting phase, it can help with hunger control, not to mention it has a high thermic effect of food. So while there are plenty of benefits to eating complex carbs, there can be some drawbacks as well, and you have to understand that you're not going to be in a calorie deficit forever. At some point, you're going to want to get your calories back up again. And when calories get higher, it can be hard to do so if you're eating nothing but really filling, high nutrient dense foods, and eating too much fiber can actually give you all the same side effects that you can get from not eating enough fiber. You can suffer from gastrointestinal stress, bloating, constipation, just feeling overall kind of run down and sluggish. Not to mention, if you're so full from eating really filling foods all the time, it's going to be hard to get your calories in. So what I typically recommend for fiber intake for most people is to eat somewhere between about 1 to 2 grams per 100 calories consumed. So for instance, if you're eating 2000 calories, that would be between 20 and 40 grams of fiber. Keep in mind, however, everyone's a little bit different. And I know people who can eat 70, 80 grams of fiber and be just fine. I know other people who can't eat as much as 15, 20 without feeling really terrible. Every body is unique and you have to understand how your body responds. So there is no upper echelon as long as you don't feel the negative side effects. So anyway, if you struggle to eat enough food, this is where simple carbs can actually help because they're less filling, they're easier to digest, which is actually a benefit if you struggle to eat enough food, which some people really do. Simple carbs can also be a really good food pre-workout because they're easily digestible and you don't necessarily want to have a really dense meal right before your workout and feel sluggish, gassy, and bloated when you're trying to work out. Of course, there is a downside to simple carbs, and that is that they are typically lower in nutrients, they're less filling, so it can be much easier to overeat on. You may also find, especially when dieting, that if you do have something like sweets, you may end up craving even more, making it that much harder to stick to your numbers. Now keep watching because I do want to dig into some research that looks at higher versus lower GI foods on actual health markers and fat loss. But first, I want to talk about a factor that's severely overlooked in my opinion, and that is how complex and simple carbs are often looked at as good or bad carbs. To me, this opens up a whole other can of worms. Foods don't have morality. If you consider eating a certain type of food as bad, you end up feeling guilty about it, and this can create a really unhealthy relationship with food. I 100% believe this. I do not think that there's such a thing as bad foods or even unhealthy foods. You have to look at it as a context of an overall diet. For example, say someone has gone 2 weeks without eating and they're literally starving to death. Do you think that eating a donut would be bad? Of course not. In that instance, a donut would be really healthy. Okay, obviously that's an extreme example, but my point remains the same. Just eating a little something that doesn't have much with regards to nutrients doesn't mean it's unhealthy, especially if you're getting sufficient nutrients from the rest of your diet. In fact, I think you could make the argument, I think a lot of people actually have binging tendencies because they look at foods as either good or bad, and whenever they get off plan, they feel like, well, they can never have it again, so they need to get as much in as possible, and they develop this really unhealthy relationship with food. Whereas if you didn't look at it like this, and you just had a little bit of whatever you wanted, fit it into your numbers, and just moved on, you would probably be more likely to stick to your diet, hit your macros for the day, and therefore see better results. And honestly, there's nothing that's more important with regards to actual health markers than the amount of body fat that you carry. So if by eating something bad helps you stick to your numbers and see better results and get you to a healthier body weight, you can almost make the argument that that's an even healthier option in that choice. Now, before you jump down my throat, again, I'm not suggesting that you just go out and eat a bunch of pizza and ice cream and whatever else you want. I'm just saying that having a little bit is not bad for you and it's not unhealthy, and we need to look at the context of an overall diet. In fact, there's a pretty good amount of research to support this, and there's actually a few studies that I looked at that I'll put in the description below that actually looked at high GI versus low GI foods where they equated total calories. And in all of these studies where all of their carbs were either consumed via high GI or low GI foods, they saw the exact same results in weight loss, body composition, blood lipids, and most health risk factors. The only difference in any of these studies was there was a slightly better decrease in LDL cholesterol in the low GI group of one of them, and this could probably be attributed to the higher fiber intake that comes from lower GI foods. And this is because fiber binds to bile acids in the small intestine and helps eliminate cholesterol. In fact, there was another study that looked specifically at sugar where they equated macros, but one group got 4% of their calories from sugar and the other group got 43% of their calories from sugar. That was the difference between consuming 11 grams of sugar or 118 grams of sugar a day. They saw the exact same weight loss, the exact same health markers almost across the board, again, with a small difference in LDL cholesterol. Once again, probably because of the higher fiber intake, but also keep in mind that even the high sugar group saw significant improvements in cholesterol. To me, you could almost make the argument that it's not even the sugar that's the problem in a high sugar diet, but more so the lack of fiber that comes from one. So once again, I'm not suggesting that you fill your diet with just a bunch of junk food, but it is clearly being shown that as long as you equate total calories and protein, and especially if you also equate fiber, it doesn't really matter what foods you eat, you're going to see the same results in both fat loss and most health markers as well. Especially if it keeps you satisfied and keeps you from going way off plan because you feel too restricted. But I do typically suggest you fill your diet with mostly high nutrient dense whole foods, as you'll not only probably feel better, but especially on lower calories, it'll help you feel fuller. And eating high sugary foods can make it pretty tough to hit your numbers sometimes. I just don't want you to feel like you can't have something if you really truly want it. There's trade-off in everything we do here, and carb sources are no different. If you are in lower calories and you really want a sugary snack and it's gonna help you feel okay, and you're still gonna hit your numbers, that's totally fine. You just have to understand the trade-off is you'll probably be a little bit hungrier and you might have to fight off some additional cravings. But even if you choose not to have it, which is probably going to be a pretty good choice most of the time, understand that it's your choice and that's a total game changer. There's a huge difference between choosing not to do something and feeling like you can't do something. Food is a big part of our lives, whether we like it or not, and we need to be able to balance our health and fitness goals with also living our life and being happy. By the way, if you'd like to know more about how to time your carbs throughout the day, make sure you check out this video and I'll talk about how to optimally time your carbs in the best way possible depending on what your goals are. I tell you exactly how I recommend to space out your meals and when to consume your carbs at each meal, so make sure you check that one out. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments below. If you're new to the channel, consider subscribing, and I'll see you next time.